there is a story unfolding. A story of humanity's progress through history, propelled by the teachings of messengers of God. Messengers guiding humanity through its stages of development, and now to the dawn of its maturity. Now is the time of Baha'u'llah, the messenger of God for this day. Baha'u'llah's teachings are vast in scope, essential in nature. Their central feature is the oneness of humankind, with all its implications for the transformation of those essential relationships that bind peoples and nations, helping them to transcend all forms of prejudice, to advance the equality of women and men, to uplift the downtrodden, and to foster economic justice. These teachings of Baha'u'llah represent an end to division and otherness. This is the time for the recognition that all people are one family, for the building of a united world that embraces the diversity of its peoples. It is a new chapter of humanity's story, a chapter that began 200 years ago.
This is the day in which God's most excellent favors have been poured out upon men. The day in which His most mighty grace hath been infused into all created things. It is incumbent upon all the peoples of the world to reconcile their differences, and with perfect unity and peace, abide beneath the shadow of the tree of His care and loving kindness. It behoveth them to cleave to whatsoever will in this day be conducive to the exaltation of their stations and to the promotion of their best interests. Baha'u'llah.
Persia, 1817. The world is asleep. It is the hour of dawn on an ordinary day when an extraordinary child is born to humanity. He will come to be known as Baha'u'llah. As a child, Baha'u'llah lives a princely life. His father is a distinguished government minister, and his ancestry goes back to the greatest dynasties of Persia. As Baha'u'llah grows to young adulthood, he turns his back on a life of luxury and prominence, and instead dedicates himself to helping the poor and the oppressed. Baha'u'llah's dedication to serving those in need stands in stark contrast with the attitudes among the nobility of the time. Later in life, he would demonstrate the temporary nature of the material world and all its riches by relating a story from his childhood. He describes watching an elaborate puppet show while still a young child, during the wedding celebration of his older brother.
When Baha'u'llah was still a child, his father arranged for one of his older brothers to marry. The festivities lasted for 7 days and nights, and on the final day there was a puppet show. A large number of princes, dignitaries, and notables gathered from the capital for the occasion, and Baha'u'llah was sitting in one of the upper rooms of the building, watching. A tent was pitched in the courtyard, and from it, soon some tiny human-like figures emerged, crying, "His Majesty is coming! Arrange the seats at once!" Other figures came out, engaged in sweeping and sprinkling of water, and then the chief town crier bade the people assemble for the audience with the king. Baha'u'llah recounts that this was a grand puppet show about a famous king and the politics and warring of his kingdom. After the show had ended, he saw a man come out from behind the tent, carrying a box under his arm. "What is in the box?" Baha'u'llah asked. The man replied, "All these lavish trappings, the king, the princes, and the ministers, their pomp and glory, their might and power, everything you saw, are all now contained within this box." Of this event, Baha'u'llah wrote, "Ever since that day, all the trappings of the world have seemed, in the eyes of this youth, akin to that same spectacle. They have never been, nor will ever be, possessed of any weight, though it be to the extent of a grain of mustard seed. Ere long these outward trappings, these heaped-up treasures, these earthly vanities, these amassed battalions, this gorgeous finery, these proud and overweening souls, all shall pass into the confines of the grave as though in that box. In the eyes of those possessed of insight, all this conflict, dissension, and vainglory hath been and will ever be like unto the sport of children."
Baha'u'llah's reputation for kindness and compassion, for insight and wisdom, becomes widespread in his native land. At the same time, a sudden and galvanizing movement begins to spread throughout all of Persia. A young man, known as the Bab, or the Gate, had arisen to awaken humanity and prepare the world for the long-awaited Promised One of all ages. Baha'u'llah becomes a prominent supporter of his cause, but the Bab's teachings are met with opposition from those in power. The clergy and the government denounce him and relentlessly persecute his followers. Thousands are murdered. A military square in Tabriz. The Bab himself is executed under dramatic circumstances.
In 1852, Baha'u'llah was imprisoned in the Black Pit and tortured with a 100-pound chain around his neck. He wrote of this time, "Upon our arrival, we were first conducted along a pitch-black corridor from whence we descended 3 steep flights of stairs to the place of confinement assigned to us. The dungeon was wrapped in thick darkness, and our fellow prisoners numbered nearly 150 souls, thieves, assassins, and highwaymen. Though crowded, it had no other outlet than the passage by which we entered. No pen can depict that place, nor any tongue describe its loathsome smell. Most of these men had neither clothes nor bedding to lie on. God alone knoweth what befell us in that most foul-smelling and gloomy place. During the days I laid in the prison of Tehran, though the galling weight of the chains and the stench-filled air allowed me but little sleep, still in those infrequent moments of slumber, I felt as if something flowed from the crown of my head over my breast, even as a mighty torrent. Every limb of my body would, as a result, be set afire. At such moments, my tongue recited what no man could bear to hear. While engulfed in tribulations, I heard a most wondrous, a most sweet voice calling above my head, 'By God, this is the best beloved of the world, and yet ye comprehend not. This is the beauty of God amongst you, and the power of his sovereignty within you, could ye but understand. This is the mystery of God and his treasure, the cause of God and his glory, if ye be of them that perceive.'"
Baha'u'llah endures 4 months of intense suffering in the Black Pit. Orders are given that he, along with his family, be banished forever from his homeland. Sick and frail, he crosses the Zagros Mountains in the bitter cold of winter to reach Baghdad. This begins a period of exile that will last the remaining 40 years of his life. For the time being, the truth of his divine mission is kept hidden. A year passes. Baha'u'llah takes to the wilderness, departing for solitude to the mountains in the region of Kurdistan. There, he immerses himself in meditation and prayer for 2 years. At length, abandoning my home and all that was therein, and renouncing my life and all that pertained thereunto, I retired alone and companionless. I roamed the wilderness of resignation. The birds of the air were my companions, and the beasts of the field my associates. The period is reminiscent of the meditation of Buddha at Bodh Gaya, the 40 days and nights that Jesus spent in the desert, and the retreat of Muhammad to the mountain of Nur. In time, the people in the area become aware of the presence of Baha'u'llah, and stories of his greatness spread throughout the region.
naught but the celestial potency of the Word of God, which ruleth and transcendeth the realities of all things, is capable of harmonizing the divergent thoughts, sentiments, ideas, and convictions of the children of men.
The life-giving words of Baha'u'llah's revelation flow with miraculous speed and force from his pen. In the course of his life, his writings would make up more than 100 volumes, writings that have now been translated into over 800 languages. During his time in Baghdad, he writes, "Is not the object of every revelation to effect a transformation in the whole character of mankind? A transformation that shall manifest itself both outwardly and inwardly, that shall affect both its inner life and external conditions?"
Verily I say, this is the day in which mankind can behold the face and hear the voice of the Promised One. The call of God hath been raised, and the light of his countenance hath been lifted up upon men.
The influence of Baha'u'llah and his teachings continues to infuriate the Persian authorities. At their urging, the Ottoman Sultan exiles him farther still from his native land. Before departing Baghdad, Baha'u'llah gathers his companions for 12 days in a garden called Rizvan on the Tigris River. It is here, with his tent pitched along the rose-lined pathways, that Baha'u'llah proclaims publicly for the first time that he is the promised messenger of God for this day. In this moment, a new era in human history begins. Everything would change. The magnitude of the transformation called for by Baha'u'llah is hinted at in some of the words he speaks regarding these days. "That which was hidden is now revealed, and that which was concealed is now come. Bestir yourselves to greet this day, a day whereon the gates of heaven have been flung open and the clouds of eternity have rained down." His words release a tidal wave of spiritual energy whose effects will extend across countless generations into the future. Baha'u'llah, along with his family and companions, is exiled deep into the Ottoman Empire. First to Istanbul, then Edirne. The authorities hope to eradicate his faith once and for all. But Baha'u'llah's influence proves unstoppable. Years pass. In 1868, he is banished yet again, this time to a harsh and remote colony on the outskirts of the Ottoman Empire, the prison city of Akka.
more grievous became our plight from day to day, nay, from hour to hour, until they took us forth from our prison and made us, with glaring injustice, enter the most great prison. And if anyone asked them, for what crime were they imprisoned? They would answer and say, they verily sought to supplant the faith with a new religion. If this be my crime, then Muhammad, the apostle of God, committed it before me, and before him he who was the spirit of God, and yet earlier he who conversed with God. And if my sin be this, that I have exalted the word of God and revealed his cause, then indeed am I the greatest of sinners. Such a sin I will not barter for the kingdoms of earth and heaven.
Baha'u'llah spends 9 years confined behind the walls of the prison city of Akka. Over time, the leaders of the city grow to love and admire him. They eventually ignore the Sultan's order and request, even beg, Baha'u'llah to leave the confines of the city. Finally, he moves to a place outside the city gates called Bahá'í. I found myself in a large apartment. A second or two elapsed ere, with a throb of wonder and awe, I became definitely conscious that the room was not untenanted. In the corner, where the divan met the wall, sat a wondrous and venerable figure. Those piercing eyes seemed to read one's very soul. No need to ask in whose presence I stood, as I bowed myself before one who is the object of a devotion and love which kings might envy, and emperors sigh for in vain. A mild, dignified voice bade me be seated, and then continued, "Thou hast come to see a prisoner and an exile. We desire but the good of the world and happiness of the nations, that all nations should become one in faith, and all men as brothers, that the bonds of affection and unity between the sons of men should be strengthened, that differences of race be annulled. What harm is there in this? Yet so it shall be. These fruitless strifes, these ruinous wars shall pass away, and the most great peace shall come." May 1892. After 40 years of suffering and exile on behalf of humanity, Baha'u'llah passes away here, in Bahá'í. His resting place, now restored and beautified, is the spiritual heart and a place of pilgrimage for millions of people around the world. People striving daily in their home communities to put Baha'u'llah's teachings of unity, justice, and equality into practice.
Concerning the uniqueness of Baha'u'llah's station and the greatness of his revelation, Shoghi Effendi affirms that the prophetic statements concerning the Day of God, found in the sacred scriptures of past dispensations, are fulfilled by the advent of Baha'u'llah. To Israel, he was neither more nor less than the incarnation of the Everlasting Father, the Lord of hosts, come down with 10,000s of saints. To Christendom, Christ returned in the glory of the Father. To Shi'i Islam, the return of the Imam Hussein. To Sunni Islam, the descent of the Spirit of God, Jesus Christ. To the Zoroastrians, the promised Shah Bahram. To the Hindus, the reincarnation of Krishna. To the Buddhists, the fifth Buddha.
There is a story unfolding. It is the story of humanity's encounter with God. An encounter playing out around the world, in villages and neighborhoods, towns and cities, in which every soul is a vital participant. It is an encounter full of promise, and illumined by the words of Baha'u'llah.
Béni est celui qui préfère son frère à lui-même.
In the garden of thy heart, plant naught but the rose of love.
كلكم أثمار شجرة واحدة وأوراق غصن واحد.
Тэгэхээр дэлхийн ертөнцөд нэг л улс орон хүн төрөлхтөн түүний иргэд юм гэж одоо хэлсэн байдаг.
Свет единства так могуществен, что может осветить всю землю.
The aim of this wronged one, in sustaining woes and tribulations, in revealing the holy verses, and in demonstrating proofs, hath been naught but to quench the flame of hate and enmity, that the horizon of the hearts of men may be illumined with the light of concord, and attain real peace and tranquility.